Shalom, peace. These days we are studying the historical books of the Bible. Today we are going to cover the first and second books of Samuel. The book of Judges ends with the note of the absence of a king. After the death of Samson, people were living a life of immorality and insecurity. Immorality in two areas: lack of respect for one God and therefore idolatry, and lack of respect for human dignity, and therefore there is a famous case of the concubine of the Levite. Against this background, we have the first and second books of Samuel. There are two parts of these two books. In the first book of Samuel, we have the end of the period of the judges, that is chapters 1 to 7. And from chapter 8 of 1 Samuel to the last chapter of 2 Samuel, that is chapter 24, we have the rise of monarchy and the period of monarchy in Israel. So let us study the first part, that is Samuel the last judge. The first seven chapters of 1 Samuel deal with the life of Samuel. It has four sections. In the first section, we have the birth of Samuel, chapters 1 to 2. This birth is placed in the context of the barrenness of his mother Hannah. Just like Sarah and Rachel in the Old Testament and Elizabeth in the New Testament. Then there is a hymn of Hannah, that is 1 Samuel chapter 2, verses from 1 to 10, which foreshadows the Magnificat of Our Lady Mother Mary, which is found in Luke chapter 1, verses from 46 to 55. The second section of this first part is the call of Samuel, recorded in chapter 3. There is a trio: the Lord, the priest Eli, and the future prophet Samuel. This trio is a prelude to the ministry of Samuel as a priest, prophet, and a judge. God takes the initiative. Eli or Eli acts as an intermediary, and Samuel as a disciple. The famous word, "Speak, Lord, your servant listens," appears in 1 Samuel chapter 3, verses 9 and 10. So the very word Samuel in Hebrew means God has heard. The author places this in contrast to Eli's sons, who did not listen to their father, and therefore Eli's line of priesthood is transferred to Samuel. The third section of this first part is the Ark of the Covenant in Philistia, chapters 4 to 6. The Ark stood for the presence of the Lord. In the Philistines' invasion, the Ark was taken to Philistia. Eli and Phinehas are killed, and the God of the nation is defeated. As soon as the ark reaches in Ashdod, one of the Philistine Pentapolis, and kept in the temple of Dagon, the god of the Philistines, a series of calamities start taking place. The falling of the statue of Dagon and sickness in Ekron. After 7 months, the ark is returned and kept in Kiriath Yearim. The last section of the first part is Samuel as the last judge. 20 years after the ark was brought back from Philistia, Samuel begins his ministry as a judge in Israel. He would carry out his work as a judge in Mizpah, Bethel, and Gilgal. Once while offering sacrifices, the Philistines approached the camp of Israel, but by God's grace they were chased, and the Pentapolis, these Pentapolis are five cities of the Philistines, namely Ekron, Ashdod, Gath, Ashkelon and Gaza, they were captured. Samuel is mentioned as a Navi, a word for prophet, a man of God, Ish Ha Elohim, and a seer, Roi, and a prophet in chapter 9, verse 6. So Samuel proclaims Saul as divinely chosen and anoints him with the flask of oil, different from anointing of David with the horn of oil. Samuel leads the group of prophets and is acting as a judge in military and judicial senses. Now we come to the second part of the books of Samuel, namely Saul, the first king of Israel, in 1 Samuel chapters 8 to 24. People ask for a king. Samuel's rise is against the sinfulness of Eli or Eli and his sons. As Eli gets old, his sons to behave unjustly. They loved money. Hence people ask for a king. Samuel made them aware of the misfortunes which will befall them, but people insisted, and therefore Saul is appointed as the first king of Israel. The period of Saul as a king of Israel is recorded in 1 Samuel chapters 9 to 31. And they can be divided under five headings. The first heading, Saul is anointed as a king in chapters 9 and 10. The narration includes five events. The first one is the loss of the donkeys of Saul's father Kish, a Benjaminite. Then meeting of Samuel and Saul. The anointing with a flask of oil. Saul prophesying like the prophets. And the public declaration of Saul's appointment as a king. Saul's success and fall, chapters 11 to 15. These chapters tell us of Saul's victory over the Ammonites, Philistines, Moabites, and Edomites. These are neighboring countries or nations around Israel. Saul's obedience after the battle with the Amalekites was a big misfortune in the life of Saul. So much so that the Spirit of the Lord leaves Saul and he is tormented by another evil spirit. It is at this juncture that Samuel confronts him and tells him that obedience is higher than sacrifice. David is anointed as the second king, chapter 16 and 17. Now God reveals his plans to Samuel, a new king from the house of Jesse the Bethlehemite. Jesse had seven sons, or rather eight sons, and seven sons were shown to Samuel, but Samuel did not approve any one of them. The eighth one was with the sheep, that is David. Samuel anointed David with the horn of oil. What is the difference between this anointing of Saul with the flask of oil and anointing of David with the horn of oil? That it was people who asked for a king, so it was in a way a human effort to get a king for themselves. Therefore, the symbol is the flask of oil. Whereas David was chosen by God himself, a man after the heart of God. And therefore, for the strength of the Holy Spirit, the symbol of horn is used. David was very humble. In spite of being anointed as a king, he kept on entertaining Saul with the playing of the harp. Saul had a difficulty when the Philistines attacked the Israelites. And the powerful Goliath was a big challenge. Against that background, we see David defeating Goliath with a slingshot. and was praised more than Saul. Saul has killed his thousands, David his 10,000s. So this gives rise to a cold war between Saul and David, which we can see in chapters 18 to 30. So there is a jealousy between Saul and David, but side by side, the author also keeps us telling about the friendship between David and Jonathan, a marvelous piece of biblical literature. Saul tries to kill David, but Jonathan tries to save him. So David does not take revenge even when there was an opportunity, because he always feared God, that I will not touch the anointed of God. Meanwhile, David also proves his military abilities. The book ends with the death of Saul and Jonathan in chapter 31. There is a war against the Philistines in the mountains of Gilboa, and this death serves as a prelude to the grief of David in 2 Samuel chapter 1. So now we come to the second book of Samuel. The second book of Samuel consists of the reign of King David over Israel for 40 long years. Among all the kings of Israel, David stands out as the most prominent figure in the period of monarchy. David is introduced as a shepherd boy already in chapter 16 of 1 Samuel. There he is anointed by Samuel as the king of Israel. However, this was a private anointing. Hence, David continues to serve the king Saul in his own humble way by playing the harp for him in his sickness, and even going to the extreme of fighting the battle with Goliath. Unfortunately, David became the object of jealousy, and Saul tried to kill David, but God comforted him through the friendship with Jonathan. Eventually, Saul and Jonathan were killed in the battle against the Philistines in the mountains of Gilboa. All these details we have seen in the last chapter of the first book of Samuel. Now, in the first chapter of the second book of Samuel, we see the grief of David over the death of Saul and Jonathan. David's grief reveals the heart of David, never resentful towards his rival king, Saul, and filled with a special affection for his friend, Jonathan. David was a God-fearing man. He would inquire of God before going out for a battle. Hence, he never lost a single battle. Chapters 2 to 5 tell us how he overcomes all the descendants of Saul and Abner, the chief soldier of Saul. He is publicly enthroned as the king of Israel, conquers Zion, and defeats the Philistines. Chapters 6 to 7 describe how David brings the Ark of the Covenant to Zion. The power and the holiness of Yahweh is manifested on the way in the death of Uzziah. The halt of the Ark at the house of Obed-Edom for 3 months is the prototype of Mary, who remained in Elizabeth's house for 3 months. David's dance before the Ark of the Covenant is further clarified in the leap of the babe John the Baptist in Elizabeth's womb at the greeting of Mary. David wanted to build a temple for Yahweh, but he was prohibited, as we can see in 1 Chronicles chapter 28, verse 3, because he had caused much bloodshed. In chapter 7, Yahweh makes a covenant with David that his kingdom will have no end. This is repeated by the angel in the Annunciation to Mary, Luke chapter 1, verse 28. Then we have chapters 8 to 10, which give a short description about the explanation of David's kingdom, the expansion of David's kingdom, his victory over Moab, Ammon, and Aram. Aram is also known as Syria. But David was not only a military man, he was a man of heart. Chapter 9 describes David's compassion for Mephibosheth, the lame son of Jonathan, in gratitude towards his friend Jonathan. Chapters 11 and 12 narrate the unfortunate event in David's life. It reveals David's weakness. The lust of the king gives way and he commits adultery with Bathsheba. After knowing that she has conceived, the king plots to kill her husband Uriah the Hittite. David thus commits two sins, adultery and murder, sins against sixth commandment and the fifth commandment. The prophet Nathan is sent to comfort the king, confront the king. The echo of the king's repentance is heard in Psalm 51. You can carefully read the superscription that is given in the beginning of Psalm 51. His dependence on God's forgiveness in such moments wins him a new life. Chapters 13 to 18 continue to present the chain of sin, punishment, repentance, and salvation and restoration. Amnon, one of David's sons, molests Tamar, the sister of Absalom, another son of David. Absalom organizes a dinner party and gets Amnon killed. Absalom runs away from David and revolts against him. Finally, he too is killed. David's grief for his son Absalom in chapter 18 reveals his compassionate heart. Chapters 19 to 24 describe the last years of David's life. These chapters give some more success stories of the expansion of the kingdom. Chapter 22 presents David's praise of God for all that the Lord has done in and through him. This chapter is a psalm of thanksgiving given in Psalm 18. It shows how devout and prayerful David was. We have 72 psalms attributed to David, who is also honored as the patron of Jewish Psalmody. However, God does not approve of his act of conducting census. The prophet Gad is sent to him. He is given three options: a famine for 3 years, war for 3 months, and pestilence for 3 days. David chooses the third option, for he says, "It is better to fall in the hands of God than to fall in the hands of man, because he is compassionate and full of mercy." 70,000 people were killed. The message is clear. The sin of the king or anyone in authority is not a private affair. It is a composite reality. It affects the whole community. The death of David is mentioned in the first and second chapters of 1 Kings, which we shall study in our next Bible class. Shalom, peace, shanti.
Sing a song to the Lord, for he is good. Sing a song to the Lord, for he is good.
It is fitting to bless his holy name, sing him anthems filled with praise, and to tell of his mercy with the dawn, and of his truth in the night.
Sing a song to the Lord,
sing a song to the Lord,
for he is good.
Sing a song to the Lord,
sing a song to the Lord,
sing a song,
for he is good,
for he is good.
very good evening to you all, my dear brothers and sisters. As we spend this time in this prayer service, reflecting on the book of Samuel, we ask God to grant us the grace, just as He has called Samuel, just as Samuel continued living the life God had ordained for him, we may experience the kingship of God in our own lives. We may choose to follow God and choose to serve Him all throughout our lives. A reading from the first book of Samuel. In those days, all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah and said to him, "Behold, you are old and your sons do not walk in your ways. Now appoint for us a king to judge us like all the nations." But the thing displeased Samuel when they said, "Give us a king to judge us." And Samuel prayed to the Lord. And the Lord said to Samuel, "Obey the voice of the people in all that they say to you. For they have not rejected you, but they have rejected me from being king over them." So Samuel told all the words of the Lord to the people who were asking for a king from him. He said, "These will be the ways of the king who will reign over you. He will take your sons and appoint them to his chariots and to be horsemen and to run before his chariots. And he will appoint for himself commanders of thousands and commanders of fifties, and some to plow his ground, to reap his harvest, to make his implements of war and the equipments of his chariots. He will take your daughters to be perfumers and cooks and bakers. He will take the best of your fields and vineyards and olive orchards and give them to his servants. He will take the tenth of your grain and of your vineyards and give it to his officers and to his servants. He will make your male servants and female servants and the best of your young men and young donkeys and put them to his work. He will take the tenth of your flocks, and you shall be his slaves. And in that day, you will cry out because of your king, whom you have chosen for yourselves, but the Lord will not answer you in that day." But the people refused to obey the voice of Samuel, and they said, "No, but there shall be a king over us, and that we also may be like all the nations, that our king may judge us and go out before us and fight our battles." And when Samuel had heard all the words of the people, he repeated them in the ears of the Lord. And the Lord said to Samuel, "Obey their voice and make them a king." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. My dear brothers and sisters, we have just heard a reading from the first book of Samuel. To give a bit background of what was happening during this time, Samuel, who was called to be a prophet and a judge for the people of Israel, continued doing the will of God, continued allowing people to experience God's grace by telling them what God wanted from them. And throughout his life, he did that. But now that he has grown old and his sons are supposed to carry on the ministry he had taken up, we realized that the sons were not being just. They were bribing people. They were doing things for their own glory, for their own selfishness. And therefore, at this point, the people of Israel, who have seen other nations having a king, who have seen other nations having their own military, wanted their own king just like them. And when Samuel is brought in front of them and they ask this question, Samuel is hurt because he realized that all this time, it was God, Yahweh, their king, who supported them, who guided them. Samuel was just a mouthpiece, a judge, who continued experiencing God's grace and allowing people to experience the same. But now that people are asking him for a new king, shows that they have not put their trust in God. They're not able to put their trust in Samuel. And therefore, when Samuel speaks to the Lord, he says, "They have not rejected you, but they have rejected me. And therefore, they will also have to bear the consequences by selecting a new king over them." And today's reading tells us of what a new king will expect from them. And he says that his new king will use their own daughters, their own sons, their own cattle, their own fields for his own purpose. Yes, to provide them with military, to provide them security, and to provide them with protection which they were looking for from the king. But God says that he gave them everything freely. He was their king. He guided them out of Egypt. He allowed them to enter the promised land, and he has been there ever serving his own people. But now, with the people asking for a new king, he's still allowing them to get the king, but he says, you will end up being his servants. The people, after hearing this, instead of feeling sorry for their choice, refuse to listen to Samuel, indirectly refusing to listen to God, and they say, we are ready to accept whatever consequences we'll have to face, but we want a king for ourselves just like the other nations. While God had chosen them out of all nations to be his own children, now they want to be just like other nations, having their own king. And that is what we see, what happens after they choose their own king. They get Saul as their king, they get David as their king, and they have Solomon as the king. But time and again, they've realized that they have been struggling and suffering and having problems when these kings have demanded from them, when the kings have asked them for many things, for protecting them, for providing them with all they want. And therefore, we realize that from that times to our times, we too have been given a choice to choose a king for ourselves. In few days, we will be celebrating the feast of Christ the King. And the question that this reading from Old Testament and even our own faith is asking us, that are we ready to accept Christ as our king? Or do we, like Israelites, want to have our own king? Want to choose things that rule us? Want to choose people that we want to enslave ourselves to? Because tomorrow we will be facing the same consequences as the Israelites faced. Because we have a king, the Son of God, who did not disobey his father, but continued his father's work, unlike the sons of Samuel. We have a king who does not demand anything else from us, rather than following him, picking up our cross, and denying ourselves. We have a king who himself has gone through all the persecution and passion and sufferings so that we might receive salvation. And the choice that we are asked, are we ready to follow this king with our hearts, our minds, and our soul? Or are we choosing our own selfish desires to enslave us? As we spend time in this Eucharistic celebration, let us ask God to make us aware each and every time when we have a choice to choose him rather than choosing our own selfish desires. As we come to the end of this prayer service, let us now say the prayer that Jesus, our Lord and our King, himself has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. But lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from all evil. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.